Hello, Railways Africa viewers. I'm here at the Mapaka train yard. Just wanted to give some thought into Eswatini Railways now that I've had a chance to go through this depot and Matsapa, the expansions that are coming there, considering the size of the railway. What they put through in tonnages is incredible. And there's still so much more to do, from increasing their volumes, unlocking the mining sector, the potential for them to participate in open access. The trial runs from here to Richards Bay, 160 wagons. So we're looking forward to seeing the outcome of that pilot. They definitely need rolling stock. And if you watch the first video that I did with Nixon, you'll see the needs that they have for locomotives, wagons, and there's volume to go with it. And there's also the opportunity for more partnerships with Eswatini Railways, and we've highlighted one already that's like quite significant. In my journey of exploring Eswatini Railways, I've also come across two fabulous women who are doing, like, I think the hardest job really at the end of the day, which is all about maintaining, refurbishing, and keeping the rolling stock moving. Traditionally, I don't think that would have been like a woman's job, but there's definitely girl power happening here at Eswatini Rail.
Baga is one of the busiest stations that we have. We provide a fueling point for our transit trains, the Transnet ones, and we also have a lot of exchange towards Mozambique. When it comes to myself, I basically oversee the traction workshop. It's not just traction for me, it's traction, the fueling vehicles and wagons, which are in Togoto. Basically, my role is to oversee those three sections, as well as provide strategic alignment as far as rolling stock is concerned.
So the availability of rolling stock kind of rests on your shoulders.
Yes, it's all on me. So that is your traction power or locomotives. You've got your wagons, and we've got quite a few different types of wagons that we're able to service.
Behind you is a locomotive that's ready to go. It's come out of service and maintenance.
It's actually currently in service, okay. But it is functional. We're currently in shutdown, so we're assisting. The lines are closed. It is moving around to ferry whatever material is required. Because Eswatini Railways basically operates 24/7, we need to be able to provide maintenance assistance 24/7. So we work on a three-shift system. You've got a technician manning the site at any time, but they should be able to move around to reach whatever part of the track that we require assistance in.
And then, you know, woman in rail, I think this is quite a big job, ensuring that you've got the rolling stock required to move the economy, because that's what Eswatini does.
Big ups to our CEO for actually identifying and not just aligning, but he is intentional about having women in the technical space. As far as his intentions, where women in rails are concerned, he's really done his bit, and he is still doing his bit. Initially, it seems like a big, scary world, but once you show your own technical articulation, your technical skills, the guys tend to fall in and they support. I think I would be lying if I said I have not received the support from the technical team, and even from up high.
What made this career attractive for you?
So for me, it started when I was 5. I'm one of those few who knew. I think I came out knowing exactly what I wanted to do. Fortunately, I had a mother who supported it. As a kid, yes, I did have dolls, but I also built model planes and model trains and model cars. So those were my toys. For me, at Eswatini Railways, it's a 360 moment. I did my internship here. Coming back here 15 years later, because I have worked elsewhere, only came to Eswatini Railways 4 years ago. So coming back here was a 360 moment. Okay. It's really heartwarming. So I feel like I belong here. especially since I've worked outside the country, putting back into the Eswatini engineering space, women in engineering space, and especially Eswatini Railways, just feels like this is where I was meant to be.
We've seen here a great push for Eswatini Rail to move more volumes. We'll see that in the next coming part of the strategy, additional rolling stock to be bought and leased. And so there are exciting things happening here at Eswatini Railways.
Hello, Sammy. Thank you very much for having me here in your depot.
Welcome to Sport for Carriage and Wagon Maintenance Depot. We are fully responsible for the maintenance of all ESR wagons, what we call preventive maintenance lifting. Just like your car goes to service every so many miles it has traveled or kilometers it has traveled. So same thing with the wagons. After so many years of being on the roads, each and everyone has to come back to the workshop, and that's what we do. We also do the repairs of these wagons. In case anything happens en route, they also come through here, and we are responsible for that. We own 595 wagons as ESR. Not all of them are in service. They're not working because maybe commodities are not being moved at that time. So it will always vary per year if we're moving that commodity. For each and every day, we have at least one wagon scheduled during the day. So we work Monday to Friday. So then we know that we have a wagon scheduled. There are things like the shutdown of the sugar season. So we'd have a two-month period where we are not doing preventive maintenance. We are now doing just focusing on brake testing those wagons that are going back into the sugar season.
How did you land up in this position? Like girl power and all.
I think Eswatini is also busy with girl power. I studied mechanical engineering in South Africa, the Vowel University of Technology. And here I was applying for a trainee job, and I grew in the position until I got to myself, become the manager for the section.
Typically, what does your day involve?
We have scheduled what wagon is coming through to the workshop. We do the analysis of what needs to be done on each wagon, and then we schedule the guys to do those changes. And the section is divided into two groups. There's the group that's inside the workshop, that is responsible for the maintenance here. That same group is also responsible for call-outs if there's a derailment. We are the ones responsible again for taking back the wagons onto the track. And any other defect that develops on route, the same team is responsible for that. Now then there's a second team who is strategically located along the line, different stations. That team is responsible for dispatching and checking trains as they come in. So they do roll-by inspections just to check if this train is still in good conditions to continue en route. So they are strategically located in different sections of the railway line, in the different Mbaga, Mlaula, Phuzumoya, and here in Stroogvlei as well, and Matsapa. So they're the ones that are responsible for dispatching trains.
You were taking me through like kind of the repair work that you do. I saw wheels outside. There's a lot of internal work. You don't really send much out?
No, not much. People must be qualified to a certain standard. The SADC region is usually aligned to what Transnet is doing, and we are certified by Transnet. It's very difficult for me to then give you my wagon to sort out when I do not know your credentials and all that. And I need to ensure that I trust what is going out there for safety purposes, of course. Some things like fabrication, that's a general mechanical element. So if there's any fabrication on the body and it proves to be a big job for the capacity we have, then we are able to then say, please, can you come through and assist us with this? But obviously with the close supervision of ourselves, so that we ensure that you're doing it according to our standard.
In terms of like spares and having components readily accessible, I'm assuming you have a storeroom full of this?
Definitely we have to, because we can't then order a part when, as and when we need it. We do have, especially the critical ones,
as bulk storage for them on site. With the assistance of the procurement team, obviously, they are able to then, we manage our depleting stocks, and then we make a call and call out to say that we are now short of XYZ, and then they will order that for us.
Are you looking at the use of technology in assisting in your condition-based monitoring and your preventative care?
This is fully heavily mechanical, so it's very slow progressing. It's not like the technological areas where things are progressing every single day. There are things, systems in place, like the tracking of this. Your car has a tracker. If it disappears, you can catch it anytime. So we have projects that need to align to that. Tracking and weighing, if the green rod team loads them incorrectly, we want to install those so that we prevent skew loads and things like that. All those technologies we're trying to install into our wagons. Engage in different projects every year. We have a caboose that we're trying to refurbish and make it look good, and probably have a tour train next time you visit.
Oh, great.
We'll have a train ride for you here instead of driving your car here. But we have a couple of projects that we like to engage in as the team, with the team, annually, and try to do something different, and that will obviously help the organization go forward.